Assalamu alaikum class, Professor Manzoor here. We are going to start a very, very important topic today, which is epidemiology. In our last four lectures, we have given you the assignments on research methodology. Just to give you a recap of what we have taught you in the start of the session. And there is a connection between research methodology and epidemiology, as epidemiology is the continuation of research methodology and they are strongly interrelated. So we wanted you to have a recap of research methodology. Let me emphasize here that the research methodology, epidemiology and biostatistics make a major chunk, and it depends upon the will of the external examiner that whether he or she wants to take this chunk or the rest of the community medicine. So the rest of the community medicine makes one chunk, and research methodology, epidemiology and biostatistics, which will be following epidemiology's lecture, makes an important chunk. So I will strongly recommend you all to follow the lectures carefully and to do the assignments regularly, because it is a difficult subject and it's a volatile subject. If you will not follow the lectures continuously, then it will be difficult for you to grasp the concepts which are given in epidemiology. Fine, so let's move towards the start of this important component of community medicine, and let's see how it plays an important role in preventive medicine. So before going to the learning outcomes, I will give you an example of the corona epidemic, which has affected the whole globe. And we will go into the history that how it started. It started with the presentation of a few cases of atypical pneumonia in the Wuhan province of China, in which the 27 people were presented with atypical pneumonia, and the people around, or the doctors around, thought that this atypical pneumonia presentation is because of a virus which is being transmitted to human beings because of the their occupation, because all of them were food handlers in the food market, which was basically dealing with the slaughtering of different animals. And the similarity of the coronavirus structure with the genetic material of the bats make an assumption that because of the contact with the bats meat, the disease is being transmitted. But soon this hypothesis was rejected, because the doctors in that area observed that this disease is now propagating. It is transmitting from person to person, and it not only involves the food handlers which were present in the seafood market, but now it is affecting other people. So the epidemiologist in that area thought that there must be some other mode of transmission for this coronavirus disease. So what they did, they started collecting data and they started observing the presentations of different people, that how they were affected by this particular virus. Soon, because of the intermingling of the people with the international travel, this disease started going towards the other countries of the globe, and it was observed that it started affecting a large number of population over a large area of the globe. So so the epidemiologist started collecting data that what is the number of people who are affected in different parts of the globe, that how much coronavirus is affecting one region or the other region, what are the mortality rates, how the number of cases are increasing day by day, what is the age distribution which is affected, what is the gender distribution which is affected. And the whole team of the epidemiologists then sat together to observe that how this virus is affecting the globe, what is its distribution, what are its rates, of new cases which are emerging? What are the rates of mortality associated with this virus? And the whole story started from a small cluster of cases, and it emerged as an epidemic, and that became the public health emergency of international concern, and then it was declared as pandemic. This is the history of the coronavirus, which shows how important is the role of the epidemiologists to assess the prognosis of a disease, to assess the pattern of a disease, to assess the natural history of the disease, to assess the rates which are related to this disease. So, moving from this scenario to the learning outcomes of epidemiology, in today's lecture, we will consider that how we will define epidemiology, why there is importance of epidemiology, that people usually think that epidemiologists are causing these patterns, and they are giving examples that how we can prevent the disease. Another important component which will be discussed today is that what are the different components of epidemiology? What are the branches of epidemiology which are playing significant role in public health? What are basically the aims and objectives of an epidemiologist, and how it is different from the clinical medicine? So, in an introductory lecture, we will only be covering the components, definitions, aims and objectives, and the differences with the clinical medicine. Let's move towards the definition of epidemiology. As you can see, that epidemiology is basically composed of three words. Epi means upon, demi means people, ology means study. So, basic function of an epidemiologist is to study the people. What is their distribution? How disease is affecting them? What are the rates of infection? What are the rates of susceptibility? What are the rates of immunogenicity? How the people get affected by the disease? Is the disease causing mortality, or it's resulting in disability of the people? How planning should be done that the disease pattern can be reduced? How effectively people should be involved in the preventive strategies so the disease can be reduced? So all these aims are basically targeted in the epidemiology. Epidemiology makes the basis of the public health. We cannot make decisions until and unless we have scientific data. And this data is collected by the epidemiologist. They want to see the time trends, how the disease is increasing in a community or it is decreasing. What are the factors which are contributing towards the increase or decrease incidence of the disease? How the populations are affected? Which age distribution? Which gender distribution? Which locality is mostly affected? What are the risk factors which are contributing towards the progression of the disease? So all this data is basically collected, gathered by the epidemiologist, and then on the basis of this data, the epidemiologist makes a hypothesis. He again collects the data to accept or reject the hypothesis, and then he makes the final version that this is the possible cause of this disease. So what are basic different components where the epidemiologists work? An epidemiologist is concerned that is what is the time, place, and person distribution of a disease? That which place is more affected? For example, in case of coronavirus infection, majority of us know that the maximum cases have been reported in America, and the countries which are affected most are Italy and Spain, which have shown a large number of mortalities and infections. Then person distribution, we all know that elderly population is affected most. The male gender, I'm sorry, the male gender is affected much more than the female gender. What was the time distribution?
In early February and late February and March, the maximum cases were reported in Italy and Spain, and then there was a decline. And in some cases, in some areas, there is second resurgence. So all this component is covered in descriptive epidemiologies, that an epidemiologist describes the disease in terms of person, place, and time. Then, after collecting the data for descriptive epidemiology, an epidemiologist makes hypothesis. Hypothesis means that what is the cause which is affecting the outcome? As I have already mentioned, that the consumption of raw food or handling of the raw meat at the seafood market in Wuhan was initially considered as the main cause of transmission of disease. But then, with the disease pattern, it was observed that person-to-person transmission is occurring. Then again, people thought, or epidemiologists thought, that the surfaces are playing an important role, and touch of these surfaces can play an important role in transmission of disease. So, hypothesis generation is an important component of epidemiology. Another important component is the analytical epidemiology, where the epidemiologist wants to find out an association between exposure and outcome. Now, he wants to accept or reject the hypothesis which is formulated by him. And by conducting analytical studies, he accepts or rejects the hypothesis and makes a confirmatory analysis that there is a relationship of exposure and outcome. Another component of epidemiology is that the epidemiologist makes a judgment that particularly this factor is a cause of disease. We all know, yes, the coronavirus causes COVID, but we have seen that there are multiple factors which can affect the presence of signs and symptoms. There are many cases who have been infected with the coronavirus, but they have not produced any signs and symptoms. They were asymptomatic. There are certain cases which were affected by the coronavirus, and they have resulted in severe respiratory distress syndrome. So we cannot say that. We can say that coronavirus is basically the etiology, but there are multiple other factors which play a significant role in the prognosis of disease and the production of the signs and symptoms. So whenever an epidemiologist wants to make a judgment, he wants to find out an association between a cause and an outcome. Another important thing is decision making for an epidemiologist. What does an epidemiologist basically do for decision making? He makes hypothesis, he collects data, and he gives preventive strategies, and he gives strategies to control the outcome. So in case of WHO, in case of CDC, in case of other preventive SOPs which are developed, these decision makings are done basically by the epidemiologist. So you can very well imagine that how much an epidemiologist is important in public health. And then evaluation of strategies. As we all know, in corona epidemic, we knew that the people are affected by severe respiratory distress syndrome. So what are the number of ventilators which should be available in hospital? Isolation wards should be available, doctors should be available, there should be availability of the personal protective equipment, there should be availability of the mask. So all the evaluation strategies, that what are the resources which are involved, are decisions which are done by the epidemiologist. So in a nutshell, I will conclude that without an epidemiologist, you cannot assess the pattern of disease. You cannot identify the risk factors of the disease. You cannot calculate the incubation period. You cannot calculate the prognosis. You cannot understand the natural history of disease. You cannot plan effectively, and you cannot make decisions in the absence of data which is generated by an epidemiologist. It is the most important component of public health. So moving towards this picture, as I have already mentioned that during this epidemic, people were concerned, epidemiologists were basically concerned that how the disease is distributed worldwide, where the maximum number of cases have occurred, which age is affected more by the coronavirus infection, which gender is affected. Why in specific area mortality rate was high? Was there any association with season? Was there any association with time? So all these things are basically collected and generated by the data which is collected by the epidemiologists, which helps us in making decisions. This is the process of decision making. The epidemiologist looks at the bars, at the charts, at the data, and then they decide that how to make preventive strategies. There are multiple branches of epidemiology. We all know for infectious diseases, we are concerned about attack rates. We are concerned about secondary attack rates. We are concerned about epidemiological triad. We have all discussed it in detail. We have discussed that how the incubation period and sign and symptoms are affected by different geographical presentations. What are the host factors which are important in infectious diseases? So infectious disease epidemiology is there. We have chronic disease epidemiology. In chronic disease epidemiology, we are concerned that what are the factors which are causing high incidence of hypertension and diabetes in modern era. What are the factors which are contributing towards cancers? How cancers can be prevented? What are the risk factors which are causing multiple increase in the cancers and obesity and other non-communicable diseases? We want to get data on chronic diseases. We want to devise preventive strategies for them. Then clinical epidemiology. Yes, as epidemiologists, we are concerned that which disease pattern is affecting most in our country. As we all know that tuberculosis is very common, extensive drug resistant and multiple drug resistant tuberculosis is there. Extensive drug resistant typhoid is now presenting. The number of cases which are affected by the dog bite is increasing. Cases with hepatitis B and hepatitis C are increasing. So we want to know that what are the diseases which are showing increased pattern of clinical diseases in our country and how we can reduce their pattern, what are the areas which should be targeted, and how should we effectively plan the control programs for these diseases. Serological epidemiology, yes. How the infection is producing herd immunity, which immunoglobulin is increasing, which is giving, which type of immunity is giving defensive control against this particular disease, which antibody titer shows prognosis. This all is studied by serological epidemiologists. Yes, we are concerned with genetics of our country. We all know that thalassemia major is much more present in Pakistan. What are the factors? Why this genetic disease is much more common in Pakistan because of the cousins' marriages, how we can curtail this genetic disease in our country, we have to effectively plan for this by collecting data. Occupational epidemiology, what are the occupational diseases which are much more prevalent in certain occupational settings? Psychosocial epidemiology, we want to know that what are the risk factors which are affecting the psychosocial health of human beings in any specific area, in a specific population. So epidemiology has a much broader scope. Let me give you an example of John Snow. He was an epidemiologist and he is called as the father of epidemiologists. In 1854, a large number of cases of cholera were reported in London, and John Snow basically started investigating that what is the cause of cholera cases in London. So he observed that there were two water companies which were supplying the area of the London. And he observed that what is the number of population in that specific area which is supplied by that specific water company. So there was Southwark Company and Lambeth Company. The Southwark Company was a bigger company, and it was serving a population of almost 1,67,654 people. Lambeth was a small company, and it was only targeting 19,133 people. So what did he do? John Snow actually collected the number of deaths which have occurred because of cholera in those areas which were supplied by these companies, and he observed that the number of cases was much more higher where the Southwark Company was providing water as compared to Lambeth. So he actually calculated death rate per 1,000 population and again compared the rates, and he made a conclusion that there is something wrong with this water company. And then he postulated that there must be some invisible bacteria or agent which is infecting this virus and then causing the disease in this specific population. And he switched the water supply, and he asked this water supply to give the water to this population, and the number of cases were drastically reduced. So by simple observation and calculating the mortality rate, he made the solution and he reduced the mortality rate in that area. So he is basically known as the father of epidemiology, because he was the first scientist or a doctor who actually collected data and made decision on the basis of data. And today we are all following John Snow, that we collect data, we analyze it, and then we make decisions. Another example is that in 1951 to 1961, it was observed that there were many British male doctors who were smoking. And as it was a closed faculty, it was easy to observe them. So the data was collected to see that what was the average number of cigarettes smoked by that doctors, and what was the annual lung cancer death rate per 1,000 in that population. And the postulation was done that with increased consumption of cigarettes, the mortality rate with lung cancer increases. Again, a very success story of an epidemiologist who has collected this data on the British male doctors. So by collecting data, you can make assumptions, you can make hypothesis of the causal relationship between the two factors as well. Moving forward, there was another study which actually was started in 1900 and it ended up in 1930, and it was done basically to assess the survival rates in the population which was more than 35 years of age. And it started from 100 non-smokers and 100 cigarette smoker people, and it was observed that from 1900 to 1930, the survival rate of non-smoker was high as compared to cigarette smokers. And there was an average difference of survival of 10 years, which again make an assumption that the non-smokers have a much more higher survival rate as compared to cigarette smokers. And the mean duration of years which improves the survival rate is about 10 years. Again, a very successful story to show the relationship between smoking and survival rates. So in epidemiology, what do? We study the frequency of disease. How do we study frequency of disease? We calculate, we collect data, and then we calculate rates. We calculate ratios. We calculate proportions to assess the frequency of death, to assess the frequency of disease, to assess the frequency of disability. Another work of epidemiologists is to study the distribution of disease, that which area is affected. Does the disease has urban or rural population difference? Does the disease affect a specific area of a country? Does this disease affect the whole globe? Amazingly, in coronavirus, the distribution shows that in Pakistan, the rural population was spared from the attack of the coronavirus. The distribution showed that it affects the rich population of metropolitan cities. So the epidemiologist wants to assess that what is the distribution of the disease. Epidemiologists want to assess that what are the determinants, what are the causes of the disease, what are the risk factors for the disease. And it's not only the disease, it's all related to disease and health-related states in specific population. And when we study all these three components related to health, it means we are covering all the three aspects of epidemiology. And then we make decisions on the basis of these data. So going towards frequency, as I have already mentioned, that we calculate rates, ratios, and proportions for disease, disability, and death. We want to calculate that what are the health needs and how we can counteract the demands of the population. We want to see that what is time, place, and person distribution. And this pattern is basically observed in descriptive epidemiology. And when we want to find out associations and causations, it means we are dealing with analytical epidemiology. Descriptive epidemiology only describes it. We cannot make hypotheses. We can generate hypotheses, but we cannot prove it. But in analytical epidemiology, the hypothesis is being rejected or accepted because the causations are developed, because the associations are developed. And on the basis of causation and association, we make plans, we make decisions, we make policies. So the aims of an epidemiology is you want to know that what is the extent of the disease, what are the causes and risk factor. You want to know the natural history and prognosis of disease. You want to evaluate that what are the preventive strategies available and what are the therapeutic healthcare delivery services available. As for example, for corona, I'm repeatedly giving corona epidemic example because it's the recent one, and we all know that therapeutic healthcare delivery system is affected, and we are undergoing a large number of drug trials. Initially, hydroxychloroquine was tried, then ivermectin was tried, then steroids role was considered. So all these decisions about preventive and therapeutic healthcare deliveries are based on the data which is generated from the patients. And then public policies are definitely made by the epidemiologist. The difference between an epidemiologist and clinical medicine is that an epidemiologist is concerned with the population. His area of interest is the total population. But in case of clinical medicine, the area of interest is only a single case which has been presented to the clinician. An epidemiologist is concerned with the source of infection, mode of spread of infection, the factors which are contributing towards the causation, the risk factors, the future control measures, etc. But the clinical medicine people are mostly concerned with the diagnosis of the single case, treatment of the single case, and prognosis of the single case. They are not related to attack rates and secondary attack rates directly. So an epidemiologist always goes through the community and wants to collect data. But for clinical medicine, patient goes to the doctor. And for an epidemiologist, the life revolves around data. Life revolves around graphs and figures, concepts, hypothesis generation. But for clinical medicine, the life of a clinical personnel revolves around clinical examination, investigations, individual decisions for the patient. So their approach is basically different. Their area of interest is basically different. So how does epidemiology work? We ask questions related to health events, that what was the health event, why it has occurred, where it has occurred,
and who was affected. And these 5 W's are related to health events are important. And then the question of how this has occurred and what health actions are taken to curtail the health related events are basically important in descriptive epidemiology. And when we want to make comparison between two populations, when we are associated to make causations, when we are interested in making associations, this is known as analytical epidemiology. And in analytical epidemiology, our approach totally is different from the descriptive epidemiology, which we will be discussing in next lecture. So I'm open to questions. And if you have any questions, you can ask me on the Facebook group or you can ask me on the WhatsApp group. Thank you so much.